Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net. Christopher Media, let's make some noise. From Asthma Core Studios near Detroit, Michigan, it's Unregimented.
Gangsters, what's up, guys?
And now, here are your hosts.
Oh, boy. Number 167,
167.
Yeah, I'm Chris.
I'm Aaron.
I'm Rich.
And I'm Earl.
Oh, he's
What's up, Earl?
Earl came back. We asked him back. He came. Glutton for punishment.
Oh, man. I don't know if this is the best week to come back.
Oh, I know, right?
Actually, it probably is.
Well, okay. So this is the week that we found out. Let's just dive right into this subject. There's no dancing around it.
Should put this is snorkel.
We finally found out
what
was in the report. We had heard rumors about Trump and some prostitutes, and these were being passed around like, senators and representatives who are on the other side,
like a joint burial, passing around
these rumors
of
what was in this report, and BuzzFeed just came out and said it. All right, he likes to see prostitutes piss on beds.
But, I mean, BuzzFeed's like, hey, listen, we don't have any journalistic integrity anyway, so let's just go with it.
I think the journalistic integrity argument is almost moot at this point, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, you had Shepard Smith getting all pious.
You can just say, well, we're not journalists then. We're just passing on information the same way, like...
Somewhere in the last decade, they have ceased to be journalists. Maybe even more so in the last 5 years. The only people I think that's got anything left is the AP. The AP is the only thing where you're still going to find who, what, when, where, and why most of the time.
Right. And also, well, I mean...
passing on news, isn't that just like Gossip Queens?
Yeah. No, it is. No? Yeah. Although... There's the argument that is made that, well, they're not, the news isn't that they're saying that this happened. The news is this is the information that the intelligence agencies have. But how does that give you any insight?
I don't know how they got it.
How does that give you any insight into what type of case they're putting together or what information might have been in that report that might have been negative towards Trump? You can just say they have some bad shit on them and nobody's talking about it.
Oh, by the way, what in the hell could Tom Arnold be sitting on at this point?
Tom Arnold's
been talking about for the last few months. He's sitting on something crazy.
He's
about
got a
Trump.
Surprise, right? I thought he would have said that already.
What are you waiting for, Tom?
How is he managing to keep that in? That's a miracle.
I know, right? Maybe it's just a shtick.
I mean, the man usually has no filter.
But this was another one of those weeks where I just sat, Mandy and I sat and looked at each other. And we're like, we live in this country.
Well,
it's one of those you kind of just face palm. You're like, wow, huh?
I think we're kind of at the point where. Because it's there's different groups that are taking credit for the breaking the story, getting the story out, however you want to look at it.
Wait a minute.
The usual suspects over at 4chan claiming that, you know, they're the ones that started the rumor, they're the ones that got the ball rolling.
Oh, okay, but for clarity, though, you're not talking about actually breaking the story, you're talking about starting the rumor.
Yes, right? exactly. And right. Then you
that
have...
All this that was supposed... all this information that came from this agent, this British intelligence agent, was actually fed to him by 4chan, right?
That's what the people, some people at 4chan are claiming. Now, people, you can dismiss them out of hand if you choose to.
Well,
but I happen to know a few people who are fairly tech savvy and have dipped a toe in the water over there. And if you remember, about a year ago, we were talking about this, maybe a little bit longer, with Jay. And Jay was like, I don't fuck with Anonymous because those people, will ruin your life if you piss them off. They will hunt you down, and they will fuck your life up beyond belief. Do not fuck with Anonymous. So, I mean, they're claiming that they planted the story and got it started. And then you have an offshoot of... I hesitate to call it an offshoot of Anonymous, but, I mean, the alt-right, who said they planted it just to prove that the mainstream media is so thirsty for anything to fucking hang on Trump that they'll jump at any right. chance they can.
Well, I mean, clearly, they're having a blast with it. Whether this is true or not, all liberals are taking this opportunity to make jokes and have fun with it and get the shit off their chest, this anger.
Saturday Night Live is going to be spectacular this week. It has to be.
And I think, yeah, obviously that's what's coming out of this. I think something that's getting lost in the reporting of this, maybe because it's too meta for news to report on this, is in the last, year and a half, we have seen all news, no matter where it comes from, mainstream, underground, bullshit like Buzzfeed, or Breitbart or whatever. Every news source can be as credible or as discredible as you choose to think they are.
I don't believe we could be a credible news source at this point.
There's nothing. We've gotten to the point where you can just go, no, that's not credible. That's not, you're just like Trump did at his press conference. No, you quiet. You're fake news. You're quiet. You're quiet.
Right.
Like a little child. He was having his little temper tantrum.
But
I'm like, that's fucking CNN, dude.
He's not setting the tone for that in that way. He's actually following the example of the people who voted for him, because I work with a lot of Trump voters, and I told you before about this, how they all sat around one day and complained about, well, I can't even read the news anymore because so much of it is fake. And then they started pointing out all these stories that they disagreed with but were from reputable news sources. They were like, this is fake, and this is fake, and this is fake. And I'm like, you can't just call everything that you wish wasn't true or that you disagree with the points that they're making fake news.
See, this is where the conspiracy...
Just like
if you've ever seen Undercover Brother, this is where Conspiracy Brother inside of me starts popping up. Because this is just perfect for a way for our enemies to completely discredit the Fourth Estate in this country. Because it's almost happened. I mean, all it would take is some people who are motivated and have a hard-on against America in general to just start doing this shit. And we're dumb enough to grab it and snowball it ourselves. We pushed the snowball down the hill for them. They just put the snowball at the top of the hill.
Right. Yeah.
And I mean, it's now it's like you said, Aaron. Oh, I don't like what this news reports. It's fake news. Well, what about for X amount of years you've cited them as a reputable source? Well, whatever. I don't feel that way anymore. And we're right back to, like we've talked about so many times, feelings trump facts these days. And it's not just for the special snowflake crowd anymore. Now it's for the fucking angry white folks, too.
But, the press only has power with the backing of the people. And I think you find a lot of situations where the people have either ignored or has been satisfied with the status quo when it comes to what they read in the press, whether it's on newspapers or television or radio. And I mean, if they were really upset over what they were hearing from the news, then they would do something with their vote and vote for people who would be accountable. So we're instead, as a nation, we tend to vote for people more who say, I don't have to be accountable to anyone. You voted for me because I'm strong and I'm a leader, and that's what the fuck I'm going to do. And I don't have to answer to anyone else now. That's it. You elected me the leader of the most powerful country in the world. That makes me the most powerful man in the world. And by that respect, nobody can question the decisions that I make.
I don't think that's how that happened, though. I think he comes out, and he did this when he was running. He comes out and creates a scene. Because if, in fact, CNN is bullshit, well, he's going to call him on it. But if they're not, they're not going to do any good stories about him. So if he could discredit him before he gets in to be president, then anything CNN runs on him, it doesn't matter. They're bullshit.
Right, it's already fake news.
It's the same thing as in high school. You know, you take a jock, and the jock goes up and runs for, you know, class president or something. The nerd over there is going to go, but I did your homework. Shut up. Nobody likes you. Right. Stop trying to drain my Kool-Aid, you know?
Right.
And then, okay, nobody's going to listen to the nerd who did do his homework, who did make him, you know, pass English. And he's just going to go ahead and become, you know, class president.
Well, dude, he feeds off of it, too. I don't think that's what everyone keeps failing to grasp. Meghan McCain, John McCain's daughter, she's a very vocal Republican critic of Trump, came out after the whole Meryl Streep thing on Sunday and was pretty much said, knock it off. This is how you got him, and you're going to get him again if you keep doing this. Like, he feeds up to, he feeds on everyone freaking out about it.
Yeah. He is, and I've said this before, just like Nixon was a vampire for power, he is a vampire for controversy. And he, for some reason, he is fucking Teflon when it comes to this.
Dude, he's a bully.
Shit.
You know what you have to do with a bully? You know what drives a bully crazy? If someone used to get bullied when they were a kid, ignore them. That drives the fucking crazy. We're not ignoring them. We keep fighting. We keep fighting them back and acknowledging them. If they ignored Donald Trump, and now he can't be ignored because he's the president.
I think he has tendencies of the bully in him, but what I see more so is, well, this is a guy who probably throughout most of his life, nobody really expected much of him. He was born to a rich dad, inherited a business. You know, you kind of expect those people to fail, and you're surprised when they succeed. Or at least that's our society's vision of that. We like the person more who builds themselves up from nothing.
Was he the prototype for Billy Madison?
And I'm not saying there's anything right or wrong with either scenario, but he kind of made his success based on fuck everyone else. Everyone else thinks I'm crazy or I'm going to fail or they don't see the bigger vision. And that has worked very well for him now. Now, that is not a good attribute to
president.
That is not a good attribute to have as a president. May have got you to the job, but it's not a good personality trait to have when you're actually doing that job. But I don't see how he could do it any other way. When you have one mode and that mode has gotten you everything you want in life, how do you turn away from that?
You don't.
That
you don't.
Fuck everyone else. Nobody sees the bigger picture that I see. Right?
He reminds me of the person who, and maybe we all know a person like this. I know a few who life in general hasn't been all that hard for, but they're just, they see everything as a personal attack on them. They can't handle criticism.
They can't handle
someone going, hey, you know what? Wait a minute. Maybe you reacting this way isn't that good of an idea. You shut up. You don't know what you're talking about.
But I know
what I'm talking about.
It goes one step further in the respect that if you are criticizing him, that means he must be doing something right. Because you're just one of the many people that told him in his life that he was crazy or stupid or whatever and couldn't do this or that. I mean, on paper, none of his shit makes sense. How do you have property and fucking golf courses and stakes and what? And you put your name on
wine.
Shit? And how do you make it? What? How does this fucking work? Like, it is purely driven by his personality. Everything in his business.
Well, watching, you know, a year-end recap from Real Sports on HBO, one of the stories they covered was him trying to set up, like, a, you know, one of the best golf courses in the world over in Scotland. And he basically fucked that up so bad that, you know, they're talking to the people that he dealt with over there, and they're like, so, what is your opinion of Donald Trump? And they're like, he couldn't get elected dog catcher in our fucking country, let alone president. So, you know, and this, and they go, this isn't an isolated incident. He comes in to situations that are already starting or are established, sticks his fingers in the pie, fucks the pie up, and then blames everybody else and walks off and walks out smelling clean like a rose. He did it with the USFL.
Hey, stop fucking the pie.
I mean, it's his, that's what he does.
But when you're the only one who sees the big picture, that means everybody else is expendable. Sure, it's horrible what happened to some people, but, you know.
He's the perfect president for the millennials.
You're fired.
Yeah. I'll give him that.
And I think that's something that a lot of people need to come to grips with and pull their head out their ass. There's a lot more support for Trump from younger people who would fall under the millennial, you know, tag, than the media wants to give it credit for. Okay, the media, after the election, especially the left-leaning media, did everything they could to put this at the feet of old white people. This is old white people's fault. This is how come we have Donald Trump. They didn't want to take a look at themselves and see, no, if you walk around labeling everything that you don't like some sort of ist or phobe, that you're
the hardcore 20 somethings that voted for him.
Help, I'm being repressed.
The hardcore right wingers, you're never going to fucking change their mind. Okay, just like the hardcore left wingers. They've got their heels dug in. They're not going to change their mind. You try to talk to them, they stick their fingers in their ears and go, la, 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 la. Well, fine.
Yeah, Bernie Sanders and Ted Cruz are never getting lunch together, ever.
But what I'm saying,
can I counter that real quick? Because that's,
yeah, go ahead.
That's everyone in both sides.
I thought I said left and right.
Oh, I.
You did?
I thought, okay, I misheard. I heard hardcore right wingers.
Do you want to hit this again?
No. And hardcore left wingers.
I take it all back. Continue on, sir. I'm sorry to be in an interruption.
My problem is the people that are in the middle or the people who are on the fence or just the people who, I guess like me, the older I get, I guess the more I'm starting to realize I'm a moderate. You know, you got to show me something besides name calling from either side. And the left just loved labeling everything that they didn't like as some sort of phobe. You know, you're a racist or you're this a phobe or whatever. And they can't see that, like, you're alienating people who would be on your side.
Yeah.
Okay, you don't, we've went over this ad nauseum, but it's just the fact that they're not getting it is amazing to me. And it really is, like you said about John McCain's daughter. Do you really want another 4 years on top of the initial 4 years? Because that's what you, do you want 8 years of Trump? Because this is how you get 8 years of Trump. Keep with your bullshit.
Hey, I got a message for both the right and the left. It's the same message for both of you. Everyone on the extreme each side. This sucks. It's not a good strategy. Like, there needs to be action. Like, just calling everything out and labeling and saying everything is bad. Like, stating the obvious is not a good strategy. That just seems what both the extreme sides seem to do. There's never a plan of action. There's always just, it's just, this sucks. It's pretty much what the extreme.
But I got to challenge you on this issue because you bring this up a lot. And I don't understand what the inverse is. What is the solution to not talk about issues that you think are worth talking about?
No, just action.
I understand that all talk and no action in most cases is worthless. But in the case of the journalist, it's all talk is the talk is the action, right? There's a lot of action in the talk. So where do you draw the line? And I don't disagree with the overall sentiment, but it's too broad, right? Because then you can just use that to say, well, somebody saying something that you think is incorrect or that you don't agree with, well, they're just all talk and no action. What are they really doing about it anyway? If they think this is so worth talking about, what are they doing about it? What are most of us doing about anything? Most of us are talking and few of us do.
Well, to Chris's point, everybody has said, this sucks, and they did take action. Problem is they went to the extreme action.
Yeah.
They elect Trump.
I think there's a very serious lack of problem solving. It was a vote based on what they knew they didn't want. On a lot of people's part. And it's trickled down from the talking heads, from the Republicans and the Democrats, down into the everyday person's thinking, to the point where if you present an issue to them and go, how do we solve this problem? Case in point, I posted an article, and I made a statement about it, and I said, now, don't come in here and start name-calling and throwing around cheap little slogans. Let's talk about how to solve this problem. And the first thing that happened was, from the people that are on my friend's list from the right, came, well, this is the result of participation trophies. And then here come the check your privilege people. And I said, okay, no, you're both wrong. And it's intellectual. We're going to have to start doing this, or else we're going to just be in a stalemate that we're in.
Right.
It's intellectually lazy to say that on either side. That's a conversation ender. Well, that's not a way to start a conversation.
Yeah, look at the current debate over what they're going to do with the ACA, which everyone goes, what? What's an ACA?
Yeah,
Obamacare. Oh, you mean Obamacare.
The quote-unquote free health care that every time I see that, it drives me.
I don't know where are you getting free from?
I know, that's just one of those little things that I see every day, that every time I get my nose...
Why does ACA doesn't say free in it anywhere? What are you talking about?
It's not free. And
No.
And the government is forced
you... Where are you getting this free from?
Yeah, the government is forcing you to spend money. Like, everyone has insurance now, yes, that they have to pay for. And guess what? If you don't pay for it, you do pay for it. You pay for it on April 15th. It's a tiered system, and at some point, I believe...
If you heard somebody say that this system was going to be free health care, then you heard wrong.
It is rampant on memes throughout, especially with Obama going out of office. There's so many things coming out from people on the right about things Obama did. You know, on all of them, it says free health care for everyone. No, it is not. You pay for it. You have to pay for it. On April 15th, you will pay for it. And the government has set you up to, after 3 years, they basically go, hey, it is now cheaper to have insurance and to keep paying us your fee. It is not free. Sorry. Getting off topic.
Yeah, I don't... That's ridiculous. I mean, you might have gotten some sort of plan, or maybe you got it on Medicaid. And got some, checkups for free, or some generic medications for free. No health care is free. Nothing's free.
Obama didn't give you anything for free. He forced you to get insurance. And then you got people, well, no one put a gun to my head. I'm like, if you did not.
That's why you never saw it. Well, okay, but my example, though, to get back on track. The reason I wanted to bring this up is because we have the exact opposite of what happened when they were trying to put together the ACA. At the time, it was a bunch of Democrats saying, we got to solve this problem. This is a major problem. We got to solve it. And all the Republicans were like, don't do it. We told you not to do it. We don't have anything to do with it, and we'll vote down anything you do. And if we can't, we'll repeal it as soon as you're out of office. And now here they are in a situation where they're like, we got this problem. We got to do something about it right now. And what are the Democrats doing? Hands off. We're not even touching it. We don't want to be part of this process at all. You're just going to fuck it up. Well, you know what? They're going to do it anyway. So can we at least get something out of it?
I got to say to you Republicans, is my premium going to go back down? Probably not.
Fuck,
so fuck you.
Fuck no.
It's doubled since the ACA went into effect. Am I going to start getting money back? You going to bring my cost down? No. Let's get the fuck out of here.
You're telling me that somebody out there has a plan to replace it, and they're just not talking about it at this point?
Yeah.
Fuck no.
It's just like nobody has a clue. Your freedoms, it's just like anything else. The minute they start regulating that you can't do something, the odds of you getting it back are astronomical.
Right.
I'm really, if it wasn't for the fact that prohibition was so massively unpopular and it gave us organized crime as we know it in this country, there's no way it had been overturned.
Can I give you, here's an analogy for you, okay? Imagine in a freak chainsaw accident, you hack your arm off at the elbow, okay?
Oh, shit. Was I drunk?
And a Democrat comes over and says, oh, shit, we got to help you. And you go, okay, what can we do? Let's get me to the hospital and get this arm back on. They go, well, we can't do that, but we can kind of bandage it really nice and make sure you don't bleed to death. And you're like, well, I'll take that. And then a Republican comes by and says, that bandage is shit, and hacks another part of your arm off so they can have another fresh spot to attach it back at some unforeseeable point in the future, by which time you'll probably bleed out.
They just put it in a cooler. They got the playmate with them.
There's my analogy for what the fuck is going on with healthcare in this country. Nobody can get your arm back on, but at least we won't bleed out with the current system.
I wanted to say that when I was talking about one of the things I posted, someone came back with something when I was like, you know, let's problem solve here. And, of course, the conversation, like I said, because the usual suspects come in with the Participation Trophy Society, this is why we are here. And this guy come in and he said something that I've never even thought of. I'm just as guilty of getting hung up on these fucking buzz phrases myself. He goes, I coach Little League, and something that I do is we have to give away participation trophies at the end of the season. What I do with my team is every player on the team gets a trophy that highlights their best attribute that they brought to the team. So if, you know, he was the best outfielder on the team, then he doesn't get a trophy that says participation trophy. He gets a trophy that says best outfielder on, you know, whatever Little League team he's on for the year he played.
Right.
And if he's the best pitcher, or if he's the best fielder, or if he had the highest batting average or the most stolen bases. Mm-hmm. And I was like, God damn, that's genius.
That kind of, okay? But that makes sense for something like baseball because it highlights how much of a team sport it is.
But you can
be the best runner or the best hitter, but if the rest of your team's shit, where's it going to get you?
And it also, it takes away the, well, everybody gets a trophy, everybody's special. It's like, no, it's actually saying you're the best at doing something.
Everyone's on this team because they're good at doing something.
Exactly. And it's going to hopefully, I mean, there's some people you just can't motivate, but hopefully it's going to motivate them to go, oh, well, then maybe I should strive to be even better at what I'm doing.
Hey, if I got best outfielder, what if I could get good enough to play the infield? Or maybe I can get best hitter next time. Or maybe I got it in me to pitch.
But best something so...
warmer of the bench.
Something so little.
Whereas participation, what do you do next year? I don't give a fuck. I'm going to get an award at the end of the season anyway. I don't got to try.
But do you see how many times we've talked about it? How many times it's been talked about in media? And something so little for a solution that no one thought of, because we're all arguing about whether we should be giving these trophies out or whatsoever. The truth is, these trophies are here to fucking stay. They're not going anywhere. All right. Parents won't allow it. Leagues won't allow it. So instead of dumbing down to the lowest common denominator and going, hey, you showed up, good job, praise them for what they do well. That makes more sense.
But we like to talk about trophies and the everyone gets a trophy mindset as shorthand for a whole generation of people, which is fairly lazy when it comes right down to it. You know, we're not talking about, it's not trophies and everybody feeling like
it's communism.
yeah,
it is.
No, you're right.
Like, I don't know. Like the last few months with everyone talk about this level playing field shit, I want to Google Russia in 1940s. All right? That's what you get when everyone's on a level playing field.
Or again, the Chinese Cultural Revolution.
And then our government would be more ethical about it. Really?
Right.
Really?
Where you would,
really, do you think our government would?
Right.
Really?
These are societies where you weren't even allowed to be the best painter. You're painted. If you painted something that was better than everyone else, then you couldn't be a painter anymore. You had to paint the traditional landscape or sunset or whatever the fuck people were into at that time and period.
Rich, I understand what you're saying about that. And I mean, because the trophies are here to stay, I guess it's a better solution. However, it still doesn't fix that problem because they need to go. Bottom line, right. They need to go.
Well, but here's my problem. Here's my problem with that attitude specifically. That ship has sailed, Earl.
Yeah.
Well, I understand.
Okay,
Wait.
Okay.
You can't sit here and bitch and say, you know, that all of these news and all these arguments that you guys are saying when we start our kids off the way they're starting off. Because that's how you get to where you are.
Man, it's, Earl,
okay, when I was in Little League, okay, we didn't get a trophy. What we got, it was taken out to ice cream. We got sat down, and we got told we lost. Not that we're losers, but we lost. We got to do this, this, and this. We got to try harder at this.
Losers don't get sprinkles.
We didn't even get ice cream unless we won.
No hot fudge for the losers. Now, Earl,
if you can't teach the kids how to lose, this is going to be happening and even get worse.
Earl, I love that mentality. Trust me, I'm with you on that, but I'm more with Rich on, unfortunately, that ship has sailed. It's just something, the bell has, you can't unring the bell. We're just throwing another cliche here.
And I totally understand what you're saying. And with that, you're not going, I don't care what the trophy says, you're not going to fix today's issues if that's the way we're going to think about it and continue about it. It's only going to get worse.
Well,
So, I mean, I understand the ship sailed. We're not going backwards. Everybody's going to still get their trophy. I got it.
So now we're back to problem solving.
Right.
It's the generation before them.
We have a generation of people coming up that is more accepting of a wider variety of people than probably any prior generation to it, but is also but is also very secluded in its own network of people. They have a certain association, and they find other people online that agree with them, and
they'll tell you how the world works, but they haven't experienced it.
I mean, they could give a fuck else if somebody else is gay or trans, this or that, or how they identify or want to be called. But if that's not part of their peer group, they're not even communicating with these people.
An other kid raccoon.
I mean, there are a lot of positive things to be said about millennials. It's just this one major thing that creates this insular thinking.
Their one flaw is a pretty big one, is what you're saying.
That allows them to do this, what we were talking about earlier, and look at news and information and decide that this one agrees with my current mindset and must be true, and this one says that I might be wrong, so this must be fake news.
That's what Barry Obama's is talking about in his farewell speech.
Not even just I disagree with the premise of this story, or I disagree with how this happened or what this is really about, but just saying it's outright, across the board, fake.
You watched the president, didn't you?
Right.
He had a whole two-minute spiel in his speech about that. Is there so many news sources we're just accepting in it? Rich, you know, I instantly, it was like, I looked at Mandy. I was like, Rich said that like 2 weeks ago on the podcast. You have all these news sources and people just,
but
this is what I got enough things to corroborate what I believe in. We'll put them here. Everything else, fuck them.
But if we're talking about generations here, I mean, how can you sway somebody from that? No, you have to trust our old news sources, because these new sources that you people are following are distributing fake news, and ours are really reliable. Now, that may be a true fact, but it doesn't change the way anybody in the younger generation is going to feel about it. Oh, I should only trust what your generation is telling me and not what my own generation is telling me? Yeah, we've heard that one before.
Don't trust anyone over 30. That was a hallmark of the boomers.
It continued on. The distrust continued.
Oh, someone on social media a few months back said, don't trust anyone over 35. I was like, whatever.
Yeah.
Did you call him an ageist
and screen capture the picture and send it to her family and work?
Oh, right.
Then you're not doing your duty on the internet.
Jesus. Yeah, that's another subject. We
don't have to go down there, actually.
I know. I'm just, because I got a whole lot to say about that. That's some bullshit. All I got to say is, when I've had that thrown at me recently, well, I'm going to screenshot what you said and send it to your mother. Well, you better get some serious smelling salts and space heaters, because the bitch is dead. Right.
You got a line to Jeebus?
Well,
what if I send it to your father? He's been dead even longer.
And what are you going to run and tell on me? Really?
Exactly.
You are an adult person, right?
I guess I want to try and get the final word on trophies, though. The trophy thing, or the medal, or everyone gets to be told that they're the best at everything, or it's going to burn itself out whether it goes away or not, because it loses its meaning after a while. Now, look at Biden. Did you see him weep real man tears getting that Presidential Medal of Honor? That was amazing. Go watch that shit.
I saw Barry Obama's tear up talking about his wife.
He was, yeah.
The meme that I like the best out of it is...
But that meant something to him. He wasn't raised with, like, getting medals and awards for every little thing that he did. And when you do get an award, especially, like, the highest honor a person can get, you might argue... when you
outside of the CMH, yeah, I guess.
Oh, God, can you imagine in, like, 25 years a millennial getting that award? Yeah, that's right! Yeah! Give me that award!
Right. Why aren't we all getting one?
Why'd this take so long?
Right.
That's right. Should've got this bitch 2 years ago.
I assume that mine's in the mail.
Yeah.
the Biden memes have kind of jumped back up since that happened when you got the Medal of Freedom.
It was really touching. I don't want to even crack a joke about it because, like,
oh no, you're gonna like this one. I'm telling you, dude, because it's Obama. He's putting it around his neck and Biden's kind of looking up and off into the distance, and you can still see, like, the tears in his eyes. And at the top, it says Biden saying, "In brightest day, in blackest night, no evil shall." And Obama goes, "This doesn't make you Green Lantern, Joe."
Oh, yes.
I told you. I told me like that one. Oh, God.
Now, my thing with the trophies is the best way I can put it to you, Aaron, is, okay, like my sister, for example. Terrible childhood, right? You heard that, you know, the two generations before us, they walked to school uphill both ways.
In the snow.
No, right. In snow, right. And so now our generation... We get the, well, if I did that, my mom would have smacked the hell out of me.
Yeah, she would.
A lot of people in our generation don't like how they were treated as a kid. And, like, my sister hated it so much that when she had kids, which are now the millennials, she tried so hard to not be our mother.
I've met so many people like that. I'm not... Right. I'm not a victim of abuse like a lot of people unfortunately are, but I do see a lot of people go there. Sometimes it does just continue to pass on down to the kids, but usually people that manage to get themselves together enough to be employed and keep a house, if they're having kids in that house, they're not raising a hand to them. They are pampering those kids and making sure they got everything that they fucking need.
Right, and that's how you get this mentality of the millennials.
Right. It's an extreme overreaction.
Or overcompensating.
Right. You try so hard to not be your parents that you're the exact opposite,
and it's,
which is just as bad.
Right, but how could you blame a person in that situation again when if you even try and punish your kids... You remind yourself immediately of yourself as a child being punished by your parents.
Because I look at myself now and go, do I like how I am now? Oh, I do. Come here, you little shit.
Right. No. Right. I have that luxury. But somebody who wasn't raised right, basically, you know, they're either going to go to one to two extremes. They're going to be abusive to their kids in some way or another, or they're going to be so pampering as to do them disservice when it comes to the real world.
So they're gonna repeat the cycle or break it, basically.
No, they're gonna repeat they're either gonna repeat their own cycle or they're gonna create a new cycle of bad behavior. It doesn't neutral out, right? It doesn't cancel out.
No, just they'll repeat the cycle of their parents, or they'll break the cycle and overcompensate.
Right,
but. You know, something that recently was said to me, I was having a discussion with a person who knows me probably better than even my own family. And we were talking about some of the traits I have. And I said, you know, to me, part of growing up is recognizing traits in yourself that you don't like and doing your best to get rid of them. And for me, at least, part of that is understanding why I am that way. And this person flat out looked me dead in the face, didn't blink, didn't take but a second to come up with this answer. And they said, it's because of the abuse you went through when you were a kid. And I'm like, wait a minute, really? You think that colors everything I see? And she goes, yeah, I really do. It's when you are a kid and you go through, and I'm not talking like your parents smacked you on the ass or your dad got a little overzealous with the belt once or twice. Right. I'm talking like abuse, you know, neglect, that type of stuff. When you go through that, that fucks with your head so much, and it colors everything you see for the rest of your life so much. Case in point,
unless you deal with which most people don't.
Like it took me a long time to realize this. The women in my family were much more physically abusive than the men, and so when someone says domestic violence, immediately the first thing that pops in my head is my grandmother beating on my grandfather and my mother beating on her boyfriends and my dad.
Right.
And when I hear, you know, child abuse, it flashes back to my mom wrapping a phone cord around my neck and dragging me around the, you know, the house, or beating me with a plugged-in curling iron. Like, and because I was so up in my own shit, I was like, doesn't everybody have the same, like, mental image that comes to mind when these words are said? No, they don't. Some people grow up in homes where mom was, you know, the type of mother had to walk on eggshells to keep from getting the shit beat out of them by dad, and dad beat the shit out of all the kids. That wasn't how my family was. And so I got to step outside myself and outside of my experience and realize, okay, other people have had different, even though ultimately it's all the same, it's abuse of some sort, they've had different perpetrators. And that colors the way they see the world, just as it colors the way I see the world. And I think people get so hung up on, I don't want to make the mistakes my parents made, that, like Earl said, they go so far to the opposite side that it's you can't be your kid's best friend. It's just not growing up. Okay, I don't know any other way to put it. Growing up, I was friendly with my dad. I respected my dad. My dad, I can count on one hand the times my dad ever put his hands on me. But as an adult, we became friends in a way that my mother and I never did. And I think it's because he didn't go to such extremes. You know what I'm saying? Like it wasn't okay, I'm gonna be your best friend, or I'm gonna be so lax with you that, you know, you can do whatever you want. But then on the same side, I knew if I stepped out of line, he was there to jerk a knot in my ass and get me back on the right track. Mm-hmm. It wasn't I'm gonna ignore you or I'm gonna beat the shit out of you, and those are your two options. And so what option are you going to choose? It's better to be ignored than to have the shit beat out of you on a daily basis. And, you know, so like I'm talking with my little brother. My stepmother was very much, when I was living with her, very much against corporal punishment. And I just found this out, you know, the man's 25 years old. I just found out that, you know, she whooped him a few times. And I'm like, she did? What did you do? Did you kill the dog? I mean, how this woman is totally against corporal punishment. And he's like, well, you know, I didn't deserve it. And I'm like, okay, whatever. But and his thing was, he resents her to this day for it. And I'm going, because you got spanked a few times? Like, is this? But then I think he got coddled. He got coddled constantly. He was always told he was special. He was always told that he's the smartest kid in his class. By his mother, and you're such a smart little man, and all this, and it's like...
Right, his problem wasn't the abuse, it was that he was always told that he was good no matter what, so if something's gone wrong in his life, it can't be his own fault. It must be somebody else's fault, and he points the incorrect finger at his own mother.
Right, and then you look at our president who says... No, you can't talk because your news is fake because you're going to hurt me.
Right.
No, I could.
What's important is that I feel safe, insulated, and respected, not that we solve any issues here today.
Well, I mean, that goes back to the whole...
One week from today.
And that goes back to the whole, we throw out these these buzzwords and buzz phrases.
The Rockettes performance?
Oh, yeah.
They're going to play the Imperial March.
If you've noticed, the term safe space, you know, originally it was coined for survivors of some sort of abuse or rape or something like that. And it got kind of watered down and co-opted to where everybody needs a safe space from the, you know, people who are like, you know, super snowflakey. And then the right got hold of it and started using it in a derogatory way against those people. And now it's gone back to where the people on the far left, who are using it with genuine intent, are now using it
as a slam against people on the right. Oh, that press conference, perfect example. Oh, little President Twitter Thumbs needs a safe space from CNN.
Right. Yeah. They're kind of pointing out who the real snowflakes are.
Yeah, safe space from idiots. Can we get it for the next 4 years? It'll be this show.
Right before we hit air, I tweeted out, be your own safe space. Grow a thicker skin.
Yeah.
Yeah, but at the same time, you can't be their best friend, but you can't also treat them like the ring from the Lord of the Rings. Oh, my precious.
Yeah.
Well, if you do, oh boy, I don't even want to see that generation.
That's how you get Dylan Roofs.
That's how you get who?
Dylan Roofs.
Dylan Roof.
The gentleman who walked into the church in Charleston last year.
Oh, I'm thinking Dylan Klebold. My bad. I mean, basically,
yeah, probably the same
mass situation. Murderers.
What's with the name Dylan?
It's a dumb name. That's what you get for naming your kid that stupid shit.
It's the new Dwayne, isn't it? Or Wayne. No. Wayne is the most common name of imprisoned men in the U.S. Wayne. Yes. And there's actually a guy in prison who's named Wayne.
Wayne.
Swear to God.
Wow.
But, maybe that's the new one.
Dylan is the new Wayne?
Dylan's the new Wayne.
I don't see that catching on.
Well, I mean, once you have the majority of Waynes imprisoned in this country,
after the Dylans.
Parents are a lot less likely to name their kid Wayne.
How about we start going after the Troys and Tylers?
Troy. Aiden. Tyler.
And Aiden. Aiden's got to go. I'm sorry.
I know a few.
What was that whole George? What was that whole George Carlin thing? What happened to good strong names?
Yeah.
Bob, Jim.
Yeah.
But this is Generation Xers naming their kids, so they probably figure they're going to change it on their own when they hit 14. The fuck does it matter?
Oh, God. I can't wait till the millennials start having kids.
Jesus.
And then it's going to be like, that's my government slave name. Don't call me that. Their kids are going to be like that. And I'm just going to be like, oh, isn't it great? Isn't it great to have a fucking person who doesn't know shit about shit tell you that you're fucking retarded? That's what we've been living with for the last fucking 25 years. Enjoy it.
No, millennials, their kids are going to be genetically manipulated to have to be hermaphrodites. And then they can choose which genitals to keep once they can start making their own decisions.
You know, that's something I'd like to bring up.
Yes?
OBGYNs will start being labeled as, I don't know, they'll be phased out.
Yeah, they can no longer practice their love with women across the nation.
I have no issue.
God, that was my favorite Bush quote. I heard that the other day.
I forgot about
their
that
love
one,
yeah. with women.
Their love of women. in fact, they get some women get 3 or 4 fingers of love from their OBGYN.
Mrs. Smith?
Would you like to know the sex of the baby?
You know,
don't you dare.
Just go whole hand.
I have no issue with someone who is 18, feels like they've been trapped in, they're a man trapped in a woman's body or vice versa all their life, and they want to do something about it. Yeah. I do have issue with parents giving hormones to 9-10-year-old kids.
Yeah,
who's
me too.
Doing this?
Idiots.
You won't let your kid go to a gun safety course because you don't trust them enough. You won't let them walk to school because you won't trust them enough. You won't let them stay home by themselves at 10 years old. You don't trust them enough, but you'll pump them full of hormones?
You're chemically altering their body in a stage where it is still growing. The body's still cooking, basically. You might as well just be giving them a joint to smoke every day because you're fucking up their chemistry giving them hormones at that stage of the game.
To be fair, we pump the cows that produce the milk full of hormones, and then we go, drink your milk, it's good for you! We're already stuffing them full of hormones.
Yeah, but I mean, it's playing a deity, if you will. You're fucking with science, given a child that's still developing hormones.
Well, I don't know if... Okay, Aaron, did you ever play Little League? Little League Baseball?
I played T-ball.
Were they juicing T-ball. In your little league there?
I was the pitcher.
Well, no.
You got to have the thing with the face mask on it and the square in the middle.
Well, no. What I'm getting at
is
that...
Laugh, But that play didn't start till my arm moved.
What? Yeah, everyone is waiting on me.
What I'm getting at is
I'm
that,
holding my hand up and like chewing gum and looking all intense, like I don't know what I'm going to do yet.
What I'm getting at is when I played for 3 years, and I'd probably say really starting the last year I played, they really started cracking down on kids the ages we were, you know, 12, 13, 14, throwing curveballs, throwing sliders, because of the motion you have to do with your arm and the you know, the wear and tear it puts on your, excuse me, your shoulder and your elbow, et cetera, et cetera. And they found that when kids at these young ages who are still developing are throwing pitches like this, they tend to blow out their shoulder, they blow out their elbow, they have to get Tommy John surgery at younger and younger ages. But and so they have to
get shitty shirts attached to their body for the rest of their lives. What's Tommy John surgery?
It's a part of your elbow, I believe, right?
They take it's when the ligaments in your elbow blow out, and so they basically re-thread with ligaments from, I believe, a cadaver. And
it's named after the gentleman who first had the procedure.
Thus Tommy making John, you a Frankenstein. Monster. Yeah. A Frankenstein monster.
Yes.
Ironically, is that they've gotten so good at this surgery that it now strengthens
zombies,
your...
you know.
So they always go for black guys' arms, too. Throw better, faster.
But now, ironically, they've gotten so good at the surgery that
Jewish
it actually strengthens
elbow, so
your...
I can count my money better.
It strengthens your elbow better than it ever would have been without the surgery, so...
I get one of them Dominican elbows. I will throw the fastest. Sorry.
But what I'm getting at is, so we won't let kids go out there and throw pitches that we know will destroy their arm.
Or play football.
Bo Jackson came out and said that he'd smack one of his kids in the mouth if they said they wanted to play football. And, you know, but yet, okay.
He found out baseball was clearly the better deal.
You know, so
even if he wasn't paid as much,
but you're 10 years old and you feel like you're trapped you're a boy trapped in a girl's body. Well, here we're going to pump you full of fucking testosterone. Okay, isn't it? Does no one remember what testosterone did to us when we were going through fucking puberty? Most teenage boys
want to
smash shit. Fight and fuck.
Unleash that beast earlier than it needs to be unleashed.
You know, well, and so now you're going to take a 10-year-old and you're going to pump a 10-year-old girl full of testosterone. And God forbid, and these are probably the same parents that are sitting there going, I don't want my kid on Ritalin or I don't want my kid to get vaccinated, but pump them full of them.
Yeah, they buy the organic milk and the fucking antibiotic and hormone-free meat. But yeah,
she's gonna be butch.
I mean, it's just I have a real issue with that, and how we medically allow that to happen in this country, ethically, let alone legally, I don't understand.
I've never heard of anybody doing this.
There's a video going around on the internet.
Truth, Rich.
There's a video going around on the internet of a 11-year-old girl whose parents for Christmas gave her. She opened up the package, and it was her first. Hormone treatment.
Oh my God!
To transition to a man or a male,
because she had wanted this apparently.
Oh yeah. Oh, she's crying and thank you and it's being held up as like, oh, this is so progressive and this is how everybody needs to be. And it's like, wait a minute, this is a fucking child.
I would have just came at it from like the Scottish aspect.
Especially with nature.
Listen, you're gonna get a lot of free hormones in the next couple of years, and who knows what they're going to do. Why don't we see how those play out? And then if you need some additional hormones, we can see about getting you those. It's like washing your car when it's going to rain.
Well, to me, that's just irresponsible parenting. That ain't progressive.
It is. I'm downplaying it severely.
That's fucking with biology.
It is.
You want to talk about
fucking with biology. I mean, we have the ability to edit our genome now. You guys heard of CRISPR, right?
What?
CRISPR.
Like where you put the vegetables in the fridge?
They basically tooled a virus that had the ability to take your DNA and snip out a section of it and replace it with something else. And we've been able to make this into a little workhorse where we can load it with a DNA sequence of our choosing and tell
custom
it,
kid
and tell it to look for another DNA sequence that it will find, and when it does, it will snip it out and stick in the DNA sequence that it brought with it, thus allowing us to change our own DNA. Now, this technology...
Can I have a kid with the athletic abilities of a black guy?
This technology is not theoretical or experimental. It is currently in use all over the world and is actually, because it is based on a virus, basically, it is so cheap to produce and do.
Give him a 10-inch penis.
The only thing holding us back from anyone doing this, from using this to make some super virus, to trying to change the genetic structure of animals or humans, or plants, or anything.
Wait for it.
The only thing that stopped... What are you doing?
Because I think I know what you're going to say.
No, you don't. Money.
Oh.
That's the only thing that stopped it.
Let's just say morality.
It takes a lot... It takes millions and millions and millions of dollars of research just to figure out what type of sequence is going to do what in one particular sequence of DNA. So, I mean, once somebody figures that out and says, hey, I figured out this little splice of the DNA that'll make your goat produce spider webs out of its udders, and then you can go, oh, that's great. And then you mail order for a few dollars this... virus that you will inject into your goat, and it will produce spider webs. And all you have to do is tell them the sequence. Hey, I'm looking for this sequence that produces milk, and I want to replace it with this sequence from a spider that allows it to produce its web.
I can't be the only person who that sounds terrifying to.
This is a real world example. These exist. Everything that said is real and in current use, and it is freaky as fuck. It's true.
And we're worried about GMOs in our food.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Is like I'm right there with you, and I'm against the amount of hormones, and I'm not flat across the board against GMOs. I just don't think we do enough testing on them. But yeah, those are problems. But in the time it takes for those problems to come to fruition, we will have already had the ability to change just about anything about our DNA and manufacture quote-unquote perfect humans. I mean, really, at this point, the only thing that's stopping us from anyone having their whole DNA sequence is computing power, which is very likely to change. We see an escalation in computing power at a very steady rate, but it has started to slow down because we're stuck in between technologies. Our current technology of packing as much shit onto a chip as possible without it overheating is reaching a limit, and so is our current battery power. And once those two things reach the next level, which they're already experimenting with nanoparticles, they can tie them into knots, actually. They can take sequences of atoms and make it into long braided strands all put together on its own. And once we develop these types of technologies that allow us to escalate our computer power and process all this information and sequence anyone's DNA in the matter of seconds, be able to analyze what does what, we're curing all diseases and making everyone whatever they want to be. So
if they have the money,
not even. I mean, in the immediate future, yes. In the next 20 years, when this probably starts going into action in real life, yeah, it's going to be the ultra-rich, just like it's going to be the ultra-rich that are the first to visit space. Eventually, it's just going to be the norm. And
perfect white babies
right. Everywhere. You'll have people going to the moon with their fucking...
Somewhere in eternity, Hitler will weep.
With their therapy dog on their lap, farting the whole way in their sweatsuit.
They're genetically engineered.
But they're genetically engineered to be completely... disease free.
It doesn't shit.
Oh, and everyone would probably be smoking on the spaceship too, because fuck it.
It's starting to sound like you're like saying, be it Ford tough with Chevy stuff.
What?
Well, this all leads to Wall-E.
That's what I'm saying.
You guys have seen Wall-E, right? Like, eventually we end up fat blobs floating around in space, distracted by entertainment 24/7.
We end up Baron Vladimir Harkonnen.
I run that one by me again, Chief.
I said we end up Baron Vladimir Harkonnen from Dune, just on suspensors.
Oh, right. Around. Yes. Nothing, thank you.
Nope.
A okay. Dune reference.
Sorry.
Man, somebody's gonna finally do that shit that right, right?
Well, they sold the rights to Legendary Pictures, so yeah. Legendary Pictures apparently
speaking of entertainment.
Isn't Mel Gibson partially owned?
I'm not sure. I'm sure.
I want to say, yeah, Legendary has something to do with Braveheart.
I don't know.
Braveheart Part 2. The Patriot? Yeah. So, I mean, as crazy as Mel Gibson is, he can do good movies.
Oh, sure.
So, there might be hope for a Dune movie here soon. But it was a joke that fell real flat.
And yeah,
we spent way too much time talking about it now.
Like, we'll probably end up with, like, a version of Dune that's supposed to be analogous to Christianity or something like that, wouldn't we?
Well, what's really interesting is if you ever really dive into the lore behind Dune, it's roughly 10,000 years into the future, and there's brief explanations of, you know, what happened between the society we know and the society that they're in. And
right,
a lot of it has to do with rise of AI, with the converging of basically the Orange Catholic Bible, which is their religious text in that world, is basically a hodgepodge of Christianity, Islam, and maybe some Buddhist Zen type stuff. It's just it's a mixture of all of that, and then of course the AI, they rose, took over, and we had to fight them off, which is, I mean, that's an old trope in sci-fi at this point.
Yeah.
But I think 60 years ago when Dune was written.
See, I don't think that's ever going to happen. I think the more likely scenario is that, well, what are we going to do with our perfect bodies and our perfect minds when we have the perfect genes and no diseases, and we have artificially enhanced brains with artificial intelligence implanted into it? When everything is perfect, what do we have left? We have war. We can always fight over shit, right? And we're just going to war each other to death. Like, I think the more we're able to, unfortunately, stall our progress to becoming, quote-unquote, perfect people, the more we're able to stave off our own doom.
Yeah, but that's what makes us human, is being imperfect, doesn't it?
You can make that argument.
That, I mean, thumbs and reason center in the brain.
Monkeys have thumbs.
That's you. So pinkies.
All I know is it's fucking terrifying to think about shit like, because I flash to the movie Gattaca, to where instead of racial or class prejudice, it's now, well, here, when you're born, you have to, you know, we take a sample of your DNA. Oh, okay, well, you're not, you have this gene in you, even though it's regressive, maybe. So you're over here, you're part of the lower class. Oh, well, you passed the screening, you're here, you're part of the upper class. I mean,
it's manufacture a caste system.
That's the stuff of, like, sci-fi nightmares right there. I mean, that's just... Because, look, you can, if it's based on money, as far as how far you can rise, or ability, there's always a loophole in the system. There's a graft in the system. You can work your way up some way, by hook or by crook. But if it's just based on the minute you're born, you're given a test, and you're just, okay, well, you're either this or you're that, and that's it. There's no upward mobility. There's not even lateral movement.
How do we get
you're
back
just
to
stuck
talking
wherever
about
the
China?
Fuck. You're stuck.
Like Futurama, Fried the Delivery Boy.
Right. You can have he's like, great, I get an opportunity to start fresh with a whole new career. And he gets his chip put in his hand.
Yeah.
It's like a delivery boy.
Yeah.
Damn it.
Well, I mean, wasn't that kind of the beef with Russia back in the day? Was that once, if you were, you know, as you were growing up and going through the schooling, if you showed, like if you showed a natural ability for hockey, they put you in basically a hockey school and you played for the national hockey team, et cetera, et cetera. If you showed one for mathematics, you were stuck over here, and that's all you had. Like, you had no choice once right. your ability was identified.
But they were tools. I mean, this allowed them to prop these people up as examples and say, see what our society produces. We produce exceptional people who are, you know, smarter and more athletic and better people than other societies, not just because of who they were, but because of the people around them. And really, it's not the case. You just took one person at an early age and bred them to be good at one thing exclusively. And it's not like these people just started sprouting up naturally because of the communist government.
Oh, no, definitely not.
And then to dive deeper into it, then you also have what you have in India, where...
A caste system?
Yeah, if you're born to poor parents, you're fucked.
Yeah.
No chance. The end.
There's talk that this might be the last generation that adheres to a caste system in India. I mean, I don't see how much longer it could conceivably last in a society where they
keep coming over here getting all our college.
Right.
That'll go away real quickly.
I mean, just with the spread of the internet.
Yeah.
You see a whole world of people out there who aren't restricted by class systems and are able to be successful when they are born of nothing. As a matter of fact, again, that is the American hero, right? We don't respect the Donald Trump overall as a hero because he was born to his money. We tend to respect more the guy who pulls himself up by the bootstraps.
Yeah.
And
well, historically, that's what we've at least gave lip service to.
And our stories, yes, exactly. Well, that's what's important, because that's what we export are our stories.
I work with a lot of those people, man.
Our stories, we like to think that there are... Well, our stories tend to reflect the best parts of us. The worst parts of us, unfortunately, that's where we elect our leaders. But...
Well, you know, it's interesting you bring that up because...
So it's more of a do as I say, not as I do. We project an image of what we think America should be, but in reality, we like a little bit of oppression from our leaders, right? Yeah. I mean, it's a little taste of the whip is good for the morale. Keeps you in line.
Appreciate
what you have.
Hey, got those pyramids right.
Hey, slavery, get shit done. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah. Goddamn right.
But no, it's interesting you bring it up because we all grew up in and around Detroit, and in and around Detroit, it's kind of a given that if you go to a party store / liquor store, because they don't call them party stores in other parts of the country,
watch your back, as I like to call them,
my friend.
It's owned by
everybody
from the Middle East.
I'm Lebanese. I can do that.
Well, no. It's not even
boss.
Oh, ooh, that's racist to say. No, it's a fact to say. If facts are racist, then so fucking be it, I guess. But one of the interesting things is one of the party stores that I grew up going to, I it's still in my neighborhood. And if I go there, it's the same people that I grew up. You know, when they were kids, they worked there. And I actually got to know the owners, and I talked to them, and I said, you know, don't you guys go nuts? Because it's two brothers that run this place, and it's you two, and you work all the hours. And they said, well, no, because to us, when our parents came here, they bought this store, and they said, okay, here's the deal. You go to school. When you get out of school, you come here, you work. Our entire family, our entire social life was built around everybody being at this store and working in some form or another.
Right.
And when their parents retired, they took over and they did the same with their kids and their wives. And it's just, you know, people go, well, how the fuck, you know, wow, how the fuck
you do? They're stacking cash. Like those stores are pretty profitable.
Oh no!
Well, not only that,
okay,
but
both of them have multiple Cadillacs. They drive to work depending on the weather.
Well, there. I mean, yeah, there's a lot of cases of it, of the business being passed down. But again, you're saying it's just the two brothers that were running it, right?
Well,
for the
now
most
it
part,
is.
Right?
Now it
because
so
where's everybody else at fucking school getting their doctorate in some shit, getting real fucking jobs, you know?
But
back home in India, you know, reaping the benefits of the money coming in from the store wherever, or
but I guess
or somewhere in the Middle East, or.
But I guess what I'm getting at is that when you're, you know, if we had to work in a factory like with those type hours, most people would be miserable. But the factory job's going to isolate you from your family unless your whole family works there. When you own a business and it's a family business, the business becomes almost like a family member.
Right.
Okay, that's where. You know, you guys, okay, you know, the wife works there, the kids, you know, work there, they spend time there, they grow up in the store, whatever. It's easier to put in those type of hours because you have your family around you.
My grandfather had a neighborhood bodega, man. My dad and all of his siblings worked there.
But this is interesting, Rich, because this kind of actually makes me think maybe the opposite of the point that you're trying to make. Because probably the biggest criticism that people have of the millennials as a generation is work ethic. And that's kind of what everything leads to. Like, because you've been told you're special, because you've been given an award for everything that you did, you don't have a good work ethic. You're not compatible in most workplaces. And they also look at the amount of people of millennials that are, whether they go to school or not, in their 20s are living at home. And they look at that as they are not being successful. They are lazy.
Which now, I just want to say something real quick, which is shocking to me because two or three generations ago, that was the norm. You lived at home until you got married.
Right, and in most other countries, that is the norm. Like, it's it's actually very rare outside of America to have this mentality of, you're 18, get the fuck out of my house.
Oh, definitely. Definitely. When I lived in Florida,
also,
and I left home at 17, my Cuban and Puerto Rican friends were like, your family threw you out at 17? Oh, my God. And I'm like, isn't that what you're supposed to do?
Right.
You get a high school diploma, have a nice one.
And they see, and in study, I think it was Planet Money that I was listening to, and they did a survey of business owners who work with millennials and found that while, you know, there's mixed reviews because you got all different types of people. It's not like millennials are all one type of person. But it varied no different than in any prior generation. That overall, the same general amount of the population in millennials had a good work ethic as in prior generations. So it's our biggest complaints about millennials seem to be based on our own biases, I guess is what I'm getting at.
Oh, hell no.
Right?
No.
A lot of mine are based on experience with them in the workplace.
No, and not just that. I mean,
but
sitting there picketing a McDonald's because you're not getting paid $15 an hour?
Yeah.
That's that entitlement that the millennials come with.
If you showed that passion for dropping fries, you'd be making more than the minimum wage. But that's just me.
All right, well, okay. Because Earl, you kind of opened the door to something else that I wanted to bring up, that Aaron actually sent a cartoon in the group chat. Okay.
Yeah, the three employees.
Yes. Let me say how I've always seen this $15 an hour, and maybe I'm wrong in how I look at it. When you go in for a negotiation and you're trying to get as much as you can, and the person you're negotiating with is trying to pay as little as they can, you both start with numbers that you're not going to accept from the other person, okay? If I was going in to start my if there was no minimum wage and I was going in to start a negotiation for my job and I asked for $15 an hour and he countered back with $5 an hour, well,
common sense tells you that we're going to have to, you know, that's, no, we're not taking that.
Yeah.
You're going to have to meet somewhere in the middle. I've always looked at $15 an hour as the opening offer. And if you've looked at states like Michigan who have put in a graduated raise in minimum wage over X amount of years, roughly 10 and some change seems to be, you know, the middle ground. Going from what, $7.25 an hour to it's going to be $10.25, $10.50.
Oh, you're talking about just minimum wage.
Yes, yes.
Right.
So,
well, you know, okay. But minimum wage only really applies to a certain type of job, and that also is the type of job that appeals to your teenagers and maybe even people in their 20s going to school and want a, you know, part-time job. And you have big corporations that it's not the manager, you know, negotiating. They're like, this is what McDonald's has set as your starting pay, and here's your raise structure, depending on how long you are here. And that's pretty much it. But your small businessman, he never wants to pay as little as he can for an employee. There's very little benefit in him, first of all, hiring somebody that would work for $5 an hour or $7 an hour or whatever the minimum wage might be at the time.
I'm just going to let you guys finish.
Most small businessmen understand that they have to find that sweet spot where they can afford to pay you what makes you feel good about doing the work.
Yeah. There needs to be a middle ground.
If you know that you're fucking your employee over, and at some point he's probably going to go, oh, everyone else around me is getting paid a lot more.
When I was a general manager...
If that guy's a good or bad employee, he's gone.
When I was a general manager, and I was allowed to set my own starting pay rates, I would set him I'd set him a dollar above minimum wage.
Mm-hmm.
And guess who had a negative retention rate?
Right.
Me.
Because it shows... I mean...
As soon as...
There's not a lot that you can do in that type of job... As far as, you know, go over minimum wage, but it does tell you something that, you know, I value my employees enough to pay them not just the least I could.
And then as soon as the hammer came down from the company of minimum wage, the right. end, that is what you start people at.
Right.
You start getting what you pay for. You start right. getting minimum wage people.
Which your retention, I mean, how much do you save just based on retention alone? When you stack the savings, your increased payroll to keep that retention versus the amount of money that you will spend in your own time processing people, interviewing, trying to find the right people, training people who leave after a week.
Absolutely.
That is so much money invested and so much time wasted that extra dollar per person per hour on your payroll may look heavy as a bottom line number. It's a savings. It is an overall savings.
Now, here's where I am, come from the other side, because I'm on the front lines of this. But
when you put it at 15, you don't give that type of ability to the business owner, right?
Correct.
They have no choice but to start you out at minimum.
And forces you to run these insanely higher labor costs, shit's going to happen. The shit is going to roll downhill. That cartoon is going to come to...
Right. Oh, we can't reference the cartoon again without actually describing it, though. It was very simple. Three employees. The first one says, I got a raise. And the second one says, I got a raise. And the third one says, I got fired to give these two a raise. There's your $15 minimum wage.
For the last 3 years now, I've been dealing with people who have states and businesses that touch oceans. All right? Both oceans. And whether it's the state, the local, or the federal government, a lot of people, you see this McDonald's, or you see this Taco Bell, or whatever. You see this, you just think it's a big, faceless corporation. What a lot of people don't realize is a lot of these are small business guys.
Yeah.
You know, these guys put their life savings into this. They got one, now they got two, now they got three. This is how they're going to retire, put their kids through college.
Right.
All that stuff.
It's no different as a business from a convenience store or anything like that.
Now, the government shows up and just says, all right, 10% increase in your labor costs, no choice.
Right.
What do you think is going to happen? I know I've spouted it 1,000 times on social media and probably this podcast. If you hate big anything, if you hate Walmart, if you hate Starbucks, if you hate McDonald's, you should hate the higher minimum wage, at least for the fast food, because I always get caught up in this too. My bar is, can anybody do it, all right? Home healthcare workers, EMS workers, give them 20. I'd last,
right.
I wouldn't make it a shift on those jobs. All right, I'd see body right. fluid that isn't mine, right. and I'm done.
Yes.
All right, the end. My buddy's wife used to do work in assisted living. The stories she would come home with and tell us when we were getting hammered in the garage. No way, man. I'd run into one old person sucking off another old person, and I'm out of there. All right? Those people deserve... Now, teaching someone to stand there, and when the button turns green and it makes a noise, lift up the basket, that is not $15 an hour.
Okay, and I agree with that. However, the people who rail against $15 an hour, and Earl, I've seen you post these pictures on social media, Facebook, whatever, before, where it'll have like the automated kiosk that you put your order in.
Right. Hold on.
And it'll say, there's your $15 an hour. Are you happy now?
Yeah.
Here's the deal. What happens when those things break down and now you have to wait in line for 20 minutes to get your order and you're bitching and complaining? Because then you're going to think back to the days where if one employee was a fuck-up, you sent his ass home and you fired him and everybody else picked up the fucking slack. Because once one of those machines break down, that's it. It's done until someone comes in and fixes it. You ever worked in a fucking fast food industry or a restaurant industry where something like the ice machine goes down? You ain't getting it fixed that day.
No, but the point is, though, is for people, if the roster is now 20 at the restaurant, that shit comes in, it's down to maybe 10. That's the thing. There's going to be less jobs to go around.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is that the nature of it is going to be, well, they're going to try to run a skeleton crew no matter what. Okay, and the minute these automated whatever, you know, come in, they're going to run even more of a skeleton crew. So if the system, God forbid, the whole system goes down, you're shutting down your business until it's fixed.
Well,
you're not going to have 10 years, you're not going to have people that know how to do the fucking shit. And it might be one of those situations where they can't even manually input it anymore.
But
they're running such an old point of sale system that they can.
Hey, man, the big three will tell you they'll figure it out. It'll be rough the first few years with automation.
Right. Well, also, you know, it's just going to shift the market because these kids that would usually have worked at the local McDonald's, and now they only have a handful of people, and two of them are probably manager key holders, and mostly automated kiosks. So you don't get a job there, but you've also growing up with computers, and that could be your minimum wage job, is the kid who comes in and knows how to reboot the fucking automated kiosk properly and do the software update that it needs.
Okay, there's or one some job shit like that. Compared to the you replaced one out of nine, you know, that used to be there. That's a side effect. Ultimate, I think people aren't seeing coming. Like I work in the industry. It's coming. We're preparing for it. Like these things have to be profitable, not just for the big huge monoliths, but to make it profitable for people like somebody who's saved up their whole life. It's still got to be worth it for someone to buy into it. And 40% labor costs ain't going to make it worth it for anybody.
But there's a definite lag in any generation when it comes to their education and the jobs that they are then expected to do in the real world. And that lag is going to, those are going to come quicker and quicker as technology progresses. And so even in medical professions, I mean, as soon as you fucking graduate, it's like your schooling never ends. You constantly have to know, constantly have to keep yourself educated about your industry or your profession or whatever it is. Now we have a segment of the population who is unemployed because we automated our restaurants, because we shut down a coal mine, because we stopped manufacturing so many bombers in a certain state. And oh my God, these are the things that are going to wreck the economy. But we also have industries that are still desperately in need. Nursing continues to grow. and hospitals always need nurses, always. We are not anywhere near a point where we can say, we're full up on everything, okay? All the professions are taken care of, and we still have a lot of people out of work, so now we have to figure out something else.
Yeah, but the starter jobs are going to be gone.
But it's just not having the right workforce for the right economy. And that offset is going to continue to be more and more offset as technology progresses at a faster rate.
Look, I think one of the things that get overlooked when we have these conversations is, and it's the big steaming pile of shit in the middle of the room that everybody steps around and acts like they don't see.
What's that?
Is the fact that the salaries for the people who are in manufacturing, who are in production, however you want to look at it, whatever you want to look at, and the salaries of the people sitting in the offices, their salaries have grown at a rate that far outpaces the salaries at the bottom of these industries. And we never talk about that because we want to think of ourselves in America, no matter who we are, as temporarily embarrassed millionaires. That one day, we're just going to put our nose to the grindstone, work hard, and through sheer rugged individualism and being American, you know, open up a world of opportunity to ourselves.
Hey, being white helps.
Okay. And yes, that is the American dream, but what is a dream? Something happens when you're fucking asleep, all right? And a dream without a plan is a wish. And we got a whole lot of people wishing for shit. My problem is, why aren't we talking about the fact that CEOs are making 300 times what they made 30 years ago, and the people who the CEOs are making that money on their backs, are making 15 times what they were making? Why is one valued so much more than the other? Is it simply because of education? Aren't we finding out now that when the more we educate a society, that the less jobs there actually are for that? How many people would...
it's laziness. It's the same reason why we elect people who don't actually reflect our own interests. It's because we don't really want to take the time to invest. If you're doing business with shopping at a place that is owned by a publicly traded company, all that shit is public information. If you want to know how much everybody's making at the top tier at that company, you can easily find that shit out. If you want to find out about their practices and how they treat their employees, if any of that shit is important to you as to who you support with your dollar, then you will be aware enough to shop somewhere else. But
okay, you call it laziness. I think, granted, that's a part of it.
Right. Because
it's not any one thing. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, I just want to say because that I don't mean to completely discredit those people who are restricted by their own budget, by where they can actually shop, that it really comes down to where can they get the shit cheapest. I don't care who the fuck's making money off of this shit.
Was it just vilifying easier anyway? In the long run?
Much, yes, much.
The easiest way out, generally?
I think it's just a matter of a lot of it comes from, and it's a tinfoil hat time, I guess. If you're at the top, you know that there's someone always shooting for you. And the quickest way to eliminate the worry of someone coming up from behind and taking your spot is to keep the people underneath you fighting over the scraps you give them and fighting over nonsense. So let's pit them against each other based on race. Let's put them against each other based on this. No collective bargaining. No. You're going to make this, and you're going to make this, and don't tell people what you make. I've worked for people. They're like, you don't talk about what you make with your coworkers. And I'm like, fuck. First of all, motherfucker, we ain't making enough to fucking anybody to tell me what I can and can't talk about.
Another one of those notions like kicking your kid out of the house at 18 years old that seems to be exclusively American, honestly.
Yeah,
We don't talk about what we make or what we pay for shit.
You go over to Japan. They are very open.
It's common courtesy to nice television. How much did you get it for?
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly. So, and I think that's part of the reason that we've allowed this mentality to take over, that for some reason, the people that produce the products or the people that do the labor
the more physically intensive it is, somehow they deserve less money. And right. the people who think up the stuff deserve more money. And the problem a lot of the times is, and I've worked in shops where we've had engineers who sit in an air-conditioned office on their ass all day in front of a computer screen, making six figures, hand us blueprints to build something.
Hell yes, and that's us, what I'm going to be. I'm
and getting us, there. And us, the lowly, uneducated plebes, mouth breathers, whatever they, you know, however they wanted to look at it, would have to go and tell them, this isn't going to work, and we're going to tell you why. We don't care what your computer program said. This is impossible. You have to do it this way.
Computers
and then send
lie.
It back up to them.
My models work perfectly. Just build it.
But the difference is the guy designing it is doing it in theory, and we're putting it to practice.
Right.
Because we build the fucking things, and we can tell you this isn't going to work.
Oh, you run into it in the restaurant industry too, sir. It's,
yeah.
You get things sent down to you that people in a fucking boardroom came up with. You're like, someone who came up with this never worked in a store before.
Right.
Never worked in a kitchen. Who came up with this?
You can use computers to build an algorithm for the perfect whatever it is that you want. But if you fail to incorporate the human element in your design, then it's never going to work in the real world.
Exactly. When I was building parts, we had to every X amount of parts we had to check against a micrometer, make sure it fell within the range of the specs, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And, of course, it got slack with certain people. Me, I was anal about it. I always checked it more than the least, you know, the least amount they wanted me to. And as a consequence, I caught something that saved us all working another 4 or 5 hours, saved the company money in the long run, and... You know, it was like, oh, okay, well, thanks, appreciate it. Really? Really? Like, I mean, do you understand we'd have had to run almost a whole nother shift, and that would have been overtime for us, and coming out of the company's money because someone didn't do their job, and because I went behind and caught a mistake, and, you know, I don't even get a pat on the back of that a boy, but then I'm supposed to, oh, but then you're supposed to be loyal to the company. We give you a paycheck for your work. You're supposed to, you know, appreciate that.
Right. Well, you know,
that goes both ways, man.
It's not someone else's job.
Yeah. It's funny that we were ragging on India's caste system earlier, but we do have the society. The middle class tends to have this attitude of, if you're a lot richer than me, you automatically deserve respect. And if you're working a labor or service industry position, you deserve zero respect.
Well, at some point in our society, a blue collar became a prerogative term.
Right.
Or not prerogative, excuse me.
A
pejorative term.
Pejorative? Okay, yes. Yeah.
Is it pejorative?
Yeah. Yes.
Sorry.
But well, if you think about it, our caste system is all set up for the one below it to scare the shit out of the other one. Like the poor are there to scare the shit out of the middle class. The middle class are there to scare the shit out of the upper class.
Right. Everyone keep in your places and everything will keep going on fine.
Yeah. You fuck up, you go there. No!
I mean, Earl, let me ask you a question. You have a bachelor's, right?
I do.
Okay. How many jobs since you graduated have to do with the degree you earned?
One.
Okay. And with the degree you have, can you apply it to a career besides the main one that most people would go into? I mean, is it type of degree to where you could do other jobs besides, because it's in history, correct?
Right, yeah. I could be a teacher. I could be a museum curator. That's about it.
All right. And that education, I'm imagining, wasn't free and it wasn't cheap.
Oh, no.
And this is something that I try to explain to people when they go, oh, I'm going to go back to school. And I go, okay, that's nice. What are you going to do? Because here's the thing. High school, they keep their jobs based on how well you do on the standardized test.
Right.
And they're not above juking the fucking system and juking the numbers to make it look like they're doing a better job than they actually are. College, they got your money. Once you show up and once you pay, they don't give a fuck what you do when you're in there. All right. You want to go and you want to learn about some dead language that hasn't been spoken 3,000 years, knock yourself out, get your PhD in it, and enjoy starving the rest of your life. Bottom line. And that's
I think that's what we've lost in society is not everyone needs to go to college. Trade schools. That's not a bad word. Okay, getting a vocation, it's not a bad word. You know, we have these for-profit
colleges. They're making more money than college graduates right now, too, because you know, there's such a demand.
We have ITT Tech and all these, you know, for-profit schools that are diploma mills that are churning out people who, if they're lucky, will end up somewhere in a cubicle making, you know, 40, 50 grand a year
right.
until the day they retire or die, whichever comes first.
The kick in the ass for me is my job right now is pretty much that after-school job I had in high school.
Yeah, I mean...
Like, why did I waste time in college?
Like, well, if you'd taken some of those same people and sent them to a fucking HVAC school, they'd be making fucking six figures after taxes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Especially if you go where it's in demand. You go out west to Arizona, you can't live without air conditioning out there.
You know, there's another argument against the minimum wage. Okay. Let's say, okay, not that my example is perfect for this, but I work in what would be considered a skilled trade with zero education on based on that trade. So essentially, I guess I would be like an apprentice. I was brought on at a much lower wage than what that position would normally offer to come in and train and learn how the system works. And when you have too high of a minimum wage, then you deter that independent business owner from taking that kid who can't get the job now at the fast food place because everyone's making $15 an hour and it's all automated anyway, and saying, hey, why don't you come on with me and learn some shit about carpentry, or possibly even something not, like intern at an office somewhere and get in that way.
We're teaching a man to fish?
And start out in the fucking mailroom. Yeah. You know? Like, You're not just eliminating fast food jobs. You're eliminating a lot of these entry-level positions into actual careers and the flexibility that people have. Compound that with employers' cost on health care and just processing an employee in general, and they're like, we can't afford to take a chance on anyone.
Yeah. I see you coming from there. You're too expensive. It's too expensive now to take a chance. We did a sure thing.
It's too expensive to have paid interns or apprenticeships or anything like that. So we're going to have some sort of trade school for this, right? If we're going to fill these positions that don't necessarily require a four-year degree but still need to be done and still can be very lucrative careers for many people in this nation.
Right, but when we talk about minimum wage, it's for minimal jobs. It starts out for kids that are going to high school. The minimal work experience kind of thing. That's why it's minimum wage.
Right, no, I'm okay, not...
The numbers don't bear that out, though.
I'm not saying that you should keep the numbers low for somebody who's done 4 years plus probably of schooling and then is looking for a job, and they should make... less than $15 an hour. I'm saying if we're going to have to fill these positions that don't require a degree, then the minimum wage isn't helping those positions being filled. Not just at temporary jobs that you work before you find your career, or maybe during the summertime or something like that. For those who just schooling isn't working out for them, it's just not their path or what they want to do.
Well, I don't think anybody in like a craft or like something like welding or carpentry
right.
or something
Those
like
are
that,
good examples.
They shouldn't make minimum wage anyway, whether they're an apprentice or not. That's a skilled trade. That's something that's going to be only very select people
can
do.
But if I'm a skilled trade person looking to expand my own personal business, and I bring on somebody that I want to be a skilled tradesman, but they have no skill at this point, I think I would expect to hire that person in at the minimum wage.
Oh, no. No.
With the understanding that once they gain the skill, they would gain the pay that is in accordance with it. I don't think that's unreasonable.
That is unreasonable.
Well, how so?
Because I can go work at McDonald's for the same price you want me to go break my back.
Yeah. I go drop fries $15 an hour. I don't need you.
Okay, but if your trajectory is, I don't need to fucking do this, it's come September, I'm going to school and I'm out of here anyways and I'm going to get some other job. But if you don't see that in your future and you don't have a career and you don't have any education lined up, then the choice between working minimum wage with advanced.
If you're going to train somebody as an apprentice, as somebody who wants to be in that type of field, and like I said, it's a skilled trade, carpentry, welding,
right,
that type of thing. All right, they don't have plans to go to school. They don't have plans.
No, that's what I'm saying. No.
Aaron, I think you are overestimating our fellow citizens. That's the thing. Good enough is pretty much becoming like the mantra of this country. You know, why go risk shooting a nail in my foot for the same amount of wage where I can just coast dropping fries?
Or sit at a teller and be a teller and ring people through.
There's a lot of complacency in this country.
Maybe it's just me.
No, I agree because they see the future selves being a carpenter and they're like, ugh, just shoot me now. You know, I'm supposed to be a rapper. I can't do carpentry.
Okay, hold on. This is
carpentry and I get a lot of money and I build a studio.
I'm not the average person, but I keep hearing
MC Hammer.
I keep hearing, you know, oh well, these people are working, you know, minimum wage jobs. That means minimum effort. This and that.
Going to hell.
Okay. Every job I've worked where I've had minimum wage, I've never had a boss. I've always had bosses that expect maximum effort for minimum pay.
Yeah.
And they have no problem telling you, I'll find someone else who will come in here and slave for me if you won't do it.
Yeah, and I've been that guy. I've been on both sides of it.
Right. Well, I mean, there you go.
So I end up going above and beyond. My problem is, okay, you go above and beyond, and you go, okay, I got to pay my dues. Okay, we have this bullshit in our head that you got to pay your dues to get where you got. Okay, fine, whatever. I have no problem with it in theory. The problem is 6 months, a year down the road, there's no payoff for going above and beyond. There's no payoff for being the person who, you know, may come in to pick up my check and they're slammed and I work for an hour and a half off the clock to help them to get them through a rush and I don't even get a pat on the back, let alone a fucking raise. And especially when you get tired of that, especially when you see people coming in who get hired in as for managers or shift lead, and you end up training people who end up being your boss. So what do? You leave and you go to another place where you have to start over again and start paying your dues there.
Right.
And it becomes a fucking, you get trapped in a cycle.
Well, you know, to go back to the point I was trying to make about millennials and their work ethic, and how that's one of the most major criticisms. People criticize millennials like they have no work ethic, and if they fix that, then, you know, that would solve a lot of our problems. But it's not that they have an exceptional work ethic. Certainly, it's that the problem doesn't stop there, right? You combine a generation of snowflakes with the previous generation of business owners who most of them probably would have to adjust how they deal with their new employees and what they expect of them. And at the end of that line is the consumer and how much they actually expect to pay for whatever it is they're getting, you know?
I had a thought the other day.
There's nothing. You have to fix that whole chain in order to solve this future employment problem.
I thought the other day about customer service.
Yeah.
We can probably all agree it's a declining art form, correct?
It must be, because now when I get it, it feels so special.
Yes.
Like I go to pick my kids up on Fridays, and lately they love Subway, so we've been hitting up the Subway by their house. And going back to what we were talking about earlier, I believe I haven't asked them their nationality. They are a couple of dark-skinned gentlemen that are always there.
Brown?
Brown people. I guess it's okay to say that now, or do I have to be brown to say that?
Do they guarantee you they're Indian?
Yeah, I believe they are Indian. They have the mustaches for it. and I get phenomenal service. And I'm not talking about their, like, oh, pulling my chair out for me and shit and like, yes, sir, and no, sir. It's just...
wiping your seat, putting a napkin down.
They make my sandwich right. They, you know, they listen to you.
You have a low bar, man.
I mean, yeah, it's funny. Like, it's not... good service isn't necessarily something I can always put my finger on. It's just I know it when it's not there.
Right?
The absence of good service is when it's most evident.
I agree. And my thought on service was, is it the decline of the people behind the counter or, chicken or the egg, or in front of the counter? Is the service becoming shittier because we're becoming shittier people to wait on?
Again, yeah.
It's a little...
both, yeah,
little,
absolutely.
What is it? Yeah, what is it you always say? A little column A, a little column B?
Yes.
I mean, I can tell you when I worked in, you know, at pizza places.
Little column.
Oh, God. The amount of complaining and calling about things being wrong or my pizza, you said it was going to be... someone said it was going to be there in 15 minutes and it was 35 minutes.
You always
overquote. And I'm like... I'm sorry, go ahead.
You always overquote. It's easier to...
exactly.
But, sorry.
it's yes, exactly. And then I have to... okay, now I'm taking this call, and I have to help this customer. And then after I help this customer, I have to go to whatever fucking poster child for retroactive birth control that didn't listen when we said, look, 15 to 20 minutes pickup, 30 to 45 minutes delivery. And if you have any question about it, quote them an hour, because if I get there in 35 minutes, they're going to be that much more happy.
Yep.
But if you say, why you would tell someone 15 minutes for a delivery is beyond me, because from taking the order and hanging up the phone until we get it boxed and in the hot bag and out the door is 15 minutes most times.
We didn't have your pizza like predicted in advance. Brilliant. And just coming out of the oven when you called.
Exactly. And so when people would call and complain, the first thing I'd have to do is, okay, we're going to get this taken care of. Let's see what we can do. Let's start off with, you know, what exactly did you order? What was wrong with your order? Because a lot of people will call up and the first thing they say is, yeah, I just called and placed an order and had delivered, and it's all fucked up. Okay, all fucked up doesn't help me. I can't fix all fucked up. I need to know what happened. Okay, did you ask for your pizza well done? Did you ask for it lightly done? Did you ask for extra cheese? Did you ask for light sauce? What did you ask for that you didn't get? And you have to almost like a child treat these people and walk them through it. And I've been told so many times at the end of these phone calls, wow, you're so much better than the other people I've called your exact same shop when I've had problems in handling this. I'm like, it's because no one's been trained to handle this.
Right.
They've been trained to run the point of sale a computer up front. And the minute some shit happens, they turn around with these dumbfounded fucking deer in headlight. You know, looks on their faces going, someone please come help me. Right. And I just go up and I say, hey, you know what? Go catch the oven. I got this. I'm sorry. What was your issue? Oh, you had this issue? No problem. We take care of that real quick for you. No problem. That's all you got to do. All you have to do.
Right.
That's customer services. Treat them like you would want to be treated if you were on the opposite side of the counter. And that works both ways.
Yeah. In most cases, it's really being able to remove yourself from the situation. That's what most people that work service industry can't do. As soon as somebody complains, well, geez, why are you attacking me like this? And it must not be my fault. And, you know, they want to counter with something and regain their sense of power during this transaction. And all you have to do is say, even if they're saying, fuck you and your dog, it's not about me or my dog, right? It's about their sandwich.
Your dick, my mouth.
And it's easily fixed. All you got to do is listen to what they have to say and counter with a reasonable solution. And the
exactly.
whole thing is over. The whole thing is over.
And it's interesting bring up...
oh, you didn't ask for extra cheese. Where does that fucking conversation get anyone? You're going to counter with, you didn't tell me you wanted extra cheese? You think that's going to end the... oh, you're right. You're probably right. I'm just going to leave now.
You know what you say? It's just like, okay, it's just like if you take a credit card number and you have to call them back because you've ran it three times and it's been declined three times. You right. never say your card has been declined. You always say, I'm sorry, we must have taken the number wrong. I'm going to read you back your number, and could you confirm it for me?
Take any blame that you can. I mean, that's all they're looking for. It doesn't matter.
And it's interesting and so that Christian said,
"Is
it
maybe you know, they go the home and they tell their wife about how they got one over? And, oh boy, I returned this piece of crap to the store. They didn't even know. Oh man, I complain. Say, who gives a fuck? You know, he's going to go home and think about that. If you're saying you're going to go home and not think about that person, right?
It's interesting that Christian
they're going to leave your life completely.
Is it people behind the counter or the people in front of the counter?" And I was just listening to a podcast with Brian Callum and Hunter Metz, and they were talking about how we, in the last 20 years, especially with the rise of the internet, the way we debate and argue on the internet is to win. And we dismiss anything that anyone brings up that we don't like, and we start hammering our point back at them.
And how do you win? With a Hitler analogy.
That's the ultimate win. There's that. But
it just goes straight for Hitler.
It's seeped into everyday life to where people don't have a conversation without the idea in the back of their head, or even maybe a debate without the idea in the back of their head of, I have to win this debate or this conversation. And when you have someone who walks in with that attitude and they meet someone with that attitude, you're going to have a problem because nothing's going to get across, and you're not going to get anything across to each other.
Right.
And if you're working customer service, the point is to minimize the bullshit you have to deal with and to, as quickly and efficiently as possible, get the person on the other side of the counter out of the store with what they wanted, how they wanted it, with a smile on their face, as quickly as possible for everybody, because no one wants to go shopping. Me, when I go shopping, I have an agenda. I walk in, I know what I want, I walk up, I get it, I go to the counter. If it takes me longer to check out than it did to get what I wanted and get to the counter, there's a fucking problem. Someone needs to be retrained.
Right.
Whether that person doesn't know the computer or that person, whatever the fuck.
There's also, if you work for a corporation, then there's the added ability for that customer to just go over your head anyway. So then you just learn that whatever it is that you can do within reason for this person, just do it. Because the last thing you want is your boss calling you tomorrow and saying, hey, corporate called me and they want you to do this or that. And it usually ends up being a concession excessive to what they were asking for in the first place. And you should have just gave them what they want, never heard from your boss, never heard from them.
Hey man, asking to talk to somebody's boss gets shit done.
Right.
So the insides of my Mac are all like a year old.
And
for free.
And if next month your boss comes back to you and says, hey, how come you gave away all this shit here? What's this big zero where you gave away a bunch of guitar strings? What are you just giving stuff away to customer? And you explain the situation to him and how you diffused it before it ever reached his ears, he's gonna turn around and thank you.
He kept shit off his desk.
That's right.
But if anyone listening to this podcast, let me give you a little insight into a small little window, if you will, into the world of the pizza industry. 9 times out of 10, when you call a pizza shop, the first thing they'll say is, can I get your phone number? They put your phone number into the computer, and unless they have such an old, shitty point-of-sale system, they could see everything you've ever ordered.
And here's something right now. Oh, wait.
I'm sorry. What'd you say, Chris?
And what you're doing right now?
Well, not yet, but we'll get to that eventually.
Yeah.
But if you call, we put that number in, and we see that you are a repeat customer, and you spend money at our store, we're going to do everything we can to make you happy in this transaction. Even if you call with an attitude. If you call with an attitude, and it's your first time coming through the store, it's not that we're not going to try, but we're not as likely to hand you $20 worth of food at our cost, which means that's not what you're paying for it. That's our cost to fix the problem. Okay. So you need to understand, okay, if I move to a new neighborhood, I call this pizza place, I get my pizza, I ask for
you know, the works, no onions, and I got onions on it. Okay, call, say something. 9 times out of 10, without any argument, they're going to give it to you. Some places will ask for the old pizza back, some places won't, doesn't matter. But if you call and you're right off the rip, the minute they answer the phone, you're the guns of the Navarone in their face, you're not going to get good service.
Yeah.
That's just, you don't like it, take your business elsewhere, because I'm going to tell you what, I've told customers who you can, we could not please, no matter what we did, we've actually had a list hanging on the wall next to the phone. We don't serve these customers anymore. Yep. And the way we did it was, sir or ma'am, and hate to say it, usually it was a ma'am, more so than sir. It was, we have tried multiple times. I have every order you've ordered in the computer, and 2 out of 3, there's a problem with, and we give you free food. Obviously, we're not living up to your standards. So we are not going to serve you substandard service and food. Please take your business elsewhere. I'll call the owner. The owner's right behind me. Would you like to talk to him?
Rich, you know why this is mostly women, though? Because the guy called and she said, what happened? And he said, they said no.
Yeah.
You know, Patrice O'Neill has a skit about, he goes, black women get you free shit. He's like,
Polish women will get you free shit.
He's like, me and my wife.
Polish woman on somebody,
Arabic
man.
Arabic women will get you free shit too, man.
Because me and my wife walked into the Apple store and I was like, hey, I got to return this phone. It's not working. And they said, well, what happened? He goes, well, I think it got wet or something. They're like, sir, if it got wet, we don't know how to help you. And he was like, meanwhile, my wife was sitting there like a pit bull with a bag over its head snarling. And I'm like, look, I'm going to give you one more chance to fix this before I take the bag off her head and let her off the leash. And the guy's like, there's nothing I can do. And he's like, so I just took the bag off her head, let her off the leash. She went at him. 5 minutes later, she come out. We got 3 free phones and a year's free service. Yeah, man.
Dude, that's Mandy, man. Nice. Like, if I have any kind of issue, like, when we've had things with the website and I've had to deal with their tech support, dude, I hand the phone to her. Like, mm-hmm. Dude, she gets shit done. Like, they're paying me to take their services at the end of the phone call. Here.
Yeah, but...
just don't put her back on the phone.
Yeah. Position where, dude, with my wife, if we have to handle shit in person, I have to do it. Yeah. If we do it over the phone, she gets to do it.
Dude, interesting.
I have witnessed her say to people, I have nothing to do but sit here all day and talk to you. I will wait. I was like, oh, that is why we are going to get married.
That is great.
But, see, the Earl right there. You guys are like, okay, separately, you're cake with no frosting and frosting with no cake. Together, you're a cake that someone would actually go, it looks like a good cake. See what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Like that works. You compliment each other.
Yeah, well, absolutely.
On the phone, you know, she knows how to get it done over the phone. In person, I mean, people just look at me and already they're intimidated. So if I get a little, they're like, okay, we'll just hear.
Right. Well, hey, speaking of free shit, you know what else is free? This podcast.
Yeah.
This is free for listeners, although there are ways that you can support us.
Yeah.
That don't even cost you anything.
Everything that you can do to support us doesn't cost you shit.
Right. Well, not everything. They could donate to the show if they wanted to, if they really wanted to support us.
Well, it doesn't cost them extra money to donate. It's like, you know, if you toss us a 20, it's not like it's going to cost you $22.50. You just toss
it. Right. You know. Or you could support us by going through our Amazon banner.
Oh, the Amazon banner.
Yeah.
Yeah. I got the UK.
You don't pay anything extra for what you buy on Amazon, but we get a little bit of a kickback on that.
I got the UK and Canada coming online because I look at the downloads. I see where they come from. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd always thought Amazon was just one giant entity, but apparently you can get different shit on UK Amazon. And
I heard also that you can do your Prime account subscription through the banners.
Yeah, and I just did. Well. I should have did it and got the credit for myself.
Yeah, you should have got a little bit of kickback. Yeah, that's right. Damn it.
Oh, well.
I'll do it if I sign up for it.
Live and learn.
I might just binge watch every episode of Orphan Black and then just cancel it.
I don't know, man.
It's to be determined at this point. Pretty good value, though.
No, their video, they got a lot of good movies. They got a lot of good TV shows.
Yeah. And if you're getting shipped to you already, then it's a no-brainer.
You get the ancillary benefits of the shipping with Amazon Prime.
Yeah.
It was pointed out to me, you get Amazon Music. Like, everything you listen to, you can download and keep.
Books, too.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that came in when I signed up for Prime. That came in handy because I was used to paying like $1 to $1.50 per song. And I was amazed. And, you know, I don't listen to top 40 shit at all. Right. So I'm searching for stuff. It's on Amazon Prime. Download it and put it on your phone right now. And I'm like, oh, that's free.
We're shilling like, Prime you know, like Amazon's okay. a sponsor. I mean, they kind of are.
Well, that's...
But... The fact
they,
is, they everybody's
come up with a decent model to get free advertising out of people,
right? And everybody's using Amazon for one thing or another at this point.
Mandy discovered Amazon.
So if you're throwing money at Amazon, throw a little bit our way.
My list is huge now.
Yeah,
but it will come in handy for things like birthdays
and
shit.
Oh God, yeah.
Just go through and pick things off the list.
How great is that? How great is that?
Oh, I think ahead. I was like, oh yeah, build a list. Perfect.
So, other ways people can support us. Even if they don't have money to support us with or buy stuff on Amazon with, they can support us just by rating the podcast.
Yeah, you just click and you go through on the website. It just says, leave a review, and it'll take you to all the Christopher Media podcasts.
Or follow us on our Twitter.
Unregimented Pod.
Yep.
At Unregimented on Instagram.
Yep.
Email the show, unregimented@christophermedia.net.
We post links to all our shows there, so if you like our show, or if you hear one in particular you think was really good, you can share it with other people. That's a great way to support us.
And it's easy. At the bottom, you go on the homepage. We have every podcast has been posted for the last week. There's a share button right at the bottom. You click it. All your social media networks, Facebook, Twitter, Google+, Pinterest.
And they can also get our podcast directly from our website at christophermedia.net.
Yes, and we're streaming now, too.
Nothing but net.
You know, TuneIn.com is a place you can find it.
Yeah.
We got it now. Everything's fixed. The last three episodes that were uploaded to the stream are what's in the player.
Excellent.
So if you want to hear the last, maybe you like Unregimented and The Weedsman and Sporgy.
That's right. Or maybe you just like one and you never heard the others.
Like tomorrow, all three of them will be in a row in the stream.
There you go.
You know, so that's cool. And it's a way, what I've noticed just from the preliminaries, it's a way, people on the desktops, you know, perhaps you're at work, you know.
That's right.
Maybe you know what a podcast is. You're like, what the fuck's a podcast?
Or even so, like, I listen to podcasts on my phone, but sometimes if I want to listen to something that's not downloaded onto my phone, I can just pull it up at work and listen to it and stream it that way without using up my own minutes.
Yeah, that way too.
Yeah, and I can do that directly off the Christopher Media website if I want to.
Absolutely. But thanks, everybody. Blah, 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 blah. Had a lot of coffee. Thanks, everybody who's been listening. Every month's better than the last. So you're out there. You're listening. Share it. Tell people. That's how it works. We don't have no big fancy advertising budgets.
Yep.
We got good old word of mouth.
Word of mouth and a work ethic, because we're going to be back here next week doing this.
Yes.
And every week thereafter.
Thank you, Earl, for joining us again. And we'll catch you next week, guys.
See ya.
All right. Later, guys.
If you enjoy this show and want more people to know about it, head on over to iTunes, leave a comment, and rate it 5 stars. Make sure you like and share us on Facebook, and don't forget to follow us on Twitter. Just search for Christopher Media. Thank you in advance for supporting Christopher Media by clicking on the PayPal button and by clicking through to all the sponsors who support ChristopherMedia.net. Most importantly, we would like to take the time to extend an extra special thanks to you. Christopher Media could not exist without your support. Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net, and thank you for listening. Christopher Media. Let's make some noise. Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.